true story. We inducted the 2011 teams. We went in North Coast, but we're going to do the same thing. We're inducting this year's team for winning state, so we got a lot on the schedule.
I don't know what our formula is for them. Things did not go well for us in 2011. We are not going home state deniers. Those kids from 2011 won't bring it up. We'll never talk about it like it never existed. After all this, a one in a million shot, and then we're going to pretend like it never happened.
You guys should come out, get up early. You should be the easiest wake up in the world of your life. You should hop out of bed so excited. You guys have been waiting for this moment for a long time. That's it. Be the best.
Now, all the fun coming down and the practice, the dinner, that's great. We want to hear that fun. But once we walked into the lobby, we need to engage with change.
So when we got off the bus from our practice, you know, we went to the practice, we had the team dinner, and when we get off, we had two buses, and all of a sudden you see all the kids grabbing their bags or equipment bags, and the bus is parked in the back, and I'm with the coaches, and we're walking along, and I look over, and I see every kid. Every kid had their cell phone out, and they had them when they had their cell phones out. They got their bag on one shoulder, and they're just typing away, and it's just a wave of kids typing away. And I looked over and go, Jesus, it looks like a marching band.
You guys think you're brave, courage? I doubt you've got the courage to turn the phone.
So right when I saw that, and I pointed out to the coaches, the kids on the phones, is here we go again. So the next thing you know, the coaches are like, all right, coach, you got to do one of your crazy things. Do one of your crazy things. I'm going, oh, my God. Oh, come on, coach, you got to do it. You got to find a way. You got to do one of your crazy things. I'm like, so we get into the, and the parents this year made the arrangements to have that little meeting room for us. And
we're all cooped up in this this meeting room, and Macy, he went off. I mean, like, he'd been mad a lot during the year, like, you know, typical Macy being mad, but.
Do you want me to collect phones right now? Do I got to collect phones?
I didn't want to deal with their phones, you know. I didn't want to have that a problem. So I thought if I could just scare them enough.
He asked Tiger Garcia if he trusts us.
I need the answer. Tiger said, collect phones or not?
The truth was, I'd hope Tiger would say, yeah, you can trust him, coach. We're a different team.
It's a yes or no question, Tiger. You want me to collect phones? Because you admit these guys can't be trusted. All right.
So as soon as Tiger said, no, you can't trust us. I'm like, ah, damn it. Now what I got to do? Now I got to dig myself deeper because I wasn't planning on that response. And I gave him a couple more chances. You sure, Tigger? You sure I can't trust these guys? No, no, you can't trust them. Ah, darn it. Right? So I'm like, someone find me a buck. Anyway, so that was sort of done on the fly, you know.
No regrets.
It's the 2014 CIF Bowl Championships presented by Farmers. This afternoon, it's the Division III Championship as the El Capitan Vaqueros take on the Campolindo Cougars.
When I look at the beginning of the year, it's a lot of parallels with the 2011 team that went to state. We came into the year believing that our defense was going to be something where we had some returners. Not that we had shut down solid returners, but we had scattered experience. You know, I think Kevin Hall played some defensive end, but he started the year as a linebacker. And we still had guys playing new positions, but at least they'd been out on the field. You know, I wouldn't say that any one kid was a returning starter, but they had some blended play and time that gave us something to build off of on the defensive side. The offensive side, there was really just no experience there at all.
Spring practice, you're just kind of pumped to get back out on the field. Really, you know, you've been lifting for, you know, 6 months or so in the offseason. You just want to show the coaches what you got, you know, what you've improved on throughout the offseason.
Yeah, so we had there was a ton of camps this offseason. We had so many camps, people don't even remember all of them, but it was a lot of finicky stuff. It was what made our team together. We're just a bunch of goofballs, and we were just making it up as we went along. But all that time together, Reno, all that stuff in the summer, definitely created bonds.
Reno really chews you up and spits you out. I mean, it's always a struggle up there. I mean, every year it's not easy. It just really makes us come together because you just go through so much up there.
You know, the 3 days, it's hot, humid. You know, you're always sweating. You got like turf burns all over your body. You're sore. But I think, you know, just the boys up there, just us and the coaches, I think that really gives a chance like to our team to like, be successful.
But then unfortunately, you know, all of a sudden little injuries start happening. Next thing you know, we're just to get ourselves through camp. Kids are changing plans, you know, left and right. Every kid, whatever they thought they might be doing going into Reno, so many of those, what their plans were, had to be changed for the betterment of the team. So now we're from, you know, a reluctant group of kids, a little bit banged up and beat up, and we barely make it through Reno. There was never any thought that we were going to be a playoff threat. Yeah, we thought, okay, we can maybe make the playoffs. The joke was going into the year, I'd tell the kids.
You know what our theme is for Moraga this year? 5-5 and keep football alive.
Score from the StubHub Center in Carson, California. Cougar faithful fired up after a fourth down stop of El Capitan on their first drive of the game. We'll see the offense again for Campolindo. Second down and long. Stevens floats it to the outside. That's Petit. Dukes one.
falls forward. Stevens of time, hits Petit again across the middle. Down to the 40-yard line, back-to-back completions to Tyler Petit.
I don't know what type of genetical misnomer they were trying to assign to the Petit family, but being a 6'5 target over the middle is pretty nice, and Tyler Petit coming up large here.
Petit was shut out in the catch department last week in their regional matchup against Sutter.
So in the NorCal championship, didn't have a very productive game offensively. Didn't have the game that I wanted to have, and so I knew that I had to come back in the state game and I had to have a big game. Going into that game with that sort of mindset was really important and had a really good week of practice.
Get a good block on the seal by Petit across the 30 and down to the 27-yard line of El Capitan, and here's a great drive from Campolindo. Stevens back, looking left, fade route to Flowers. Flowers brings it in, touchdown, Campolindo.
Touchdown catch for Max Flower and the 6'4", 6'5", wide receiver tandem having pretty good fortune on that drive.
The kick is up and
good. Making the score, Campolindo 7, Heritage 0.
You know, game one's always like, you know, you're pumped up just to get back on the field, like actually like competing against another opponent. And, you know, really, I mean, you just want to improve each game.
It's actually funny. We had a scrim, we had like a kind of an inter-squad scrimmage the week before Heritage. And Coach Macy was really in our heads that day. It was hot and we were kind of not playing well. And they were saying that if we played that way, we'd lose to Heritage and whatever. And eventually we all kind of realized that's just what he does. And you know it's happening, but it still works and it's annoying. He'll tell you you're the worst team ever and that you're going to lose. And you know that's not the case, but you'll still end up believing it. And I think it's just part of, he's a master motivator. I think that's the best way to put it.
Once you get to the season, it's just try to get better at the plays or knowing defenses and knowing other people's offense.
Go back, we had offense and our defense played solid. So the Napa game has to go back and be one of those first little indicators. You know, first, here's our first chance, the first marker on the season. So we can find a little bit more about ourselves as we move forward. That game was the biggest game of the year. Doesn't show on the radar screen right now, but they came in, they had huge kids. They brought a big team down. And when they travel, boy, they got the big luxury buses. They got here so early. They set up in our gym. They set their own locker room, training room. You know, I looked in what they were using for their, you know, to suit up in our small gym. I looked in there going, geez, they got a better training room, better equipment room than we have. They definitely thought that this was going to be a big game for them. So there was a lot of build-up into that game. So it felt like a playoff game. It had history. It had build-up. You know, it had that marquee you know, feel to it. So, you know, I look back at that one, that, you know, finding a way to win that game, because it was really an even game most of the game. It, nothing says that, you know, we were had control of the game, and it was just sort of a little bit of a back and forth, and it just took a little, you know, a little turnover here and there to slightly, you know, alter the score. So those are things that you go back and you look and say, well, you know, we had some markers early in the year that told us some things were going to fall in place.
You know, out of the 10 games in the regular season, you improve throughout those 10 games.
Strip hit taken by the Cougars. The 13-yard line. Now it's way in the footway to the end zone. Kickoff 40, 30, 20, 10, 5. Touchdown, Cougars.
One of the more memorable, one of the weirdest parts of our run throughout the year was the beard I grew. And so I made a deal with some of the guys on the team during summer ball that I wouldn't shave until we lost a game.
Campolindo from Moraga, California in the Bay Area. That's a 7-0 lead. As Campolindo defense has sparkled early. Trips out to the left. Cagle back, looks down the middle. Caught near the 25. Cagle looking left, fires left, it's caught. That's Lima. Campolindo showing blitz, they bring more. And it's caught for a
Before the loss on this game, I remember Vince Graziano being in the shed with us after all the coaches left, and him just giving a complete super inspirational speech and getting everyone just ready for that Las Lomas game. I just remember everyone was so ready for that game.
So we come up against Las Lomas, and I knew they were going to be tough. I just think big kids, good running back, you know, quarterback was good. They were just solid. We just knew that that game was probably going to be the game that would dictate who was going to win the league. And you know, we started out rough. And, you know, that might have been a game where we didn't feel confident or look confident. It's hard to go back and think about it. But we just, you know, some balls were just a reach off the fingertips. We just didn't look like ourselves.
Three touchdowns, and that was really the first real game that we had an issue like that, but we proved that we could just fight back and back into it.
I think through the brotherhood that we built in the offseason, that made it so it could like solidify that we could come back. Because if you have doubt in your mind and if you guys aren't close together, that lead turns into a 40-point blowout and it's over in an instant. Just two more touchdowns and it's out of reach and you're done. But because we like never gave up, like we realized what happened in the first half was a bunch of fluky stuff, and we knew we just had that connection to bring it back and at least give ourselves a shot to win. And once we got a couple of TDs going and the momentum rolling, we could just feel they were backing down. They were just scared they were going to lose it. And we were just thinking about the win.
Probably my most memorable play would be my pick six against Las Lomas, because I think that was probably one of the better comebacks in Campo history, in my opinion, and I think that that was probably one of the biggest turning points in the game, because we were down just beginning our comeback, and that tied it up and really showed them that like we were coming for it. I barely got the touchdown as it was because their quarterback, being a far better athlete than me, was able to catch me. Even though he had gotten hit when he threw the ball, he got off the ground and chased me down. It kind of showed that even though we were gassed and we were like all out of energy, that we could still hold on throughout the fourth quarter and make the comeback.
When the defense sort of buckled down and just got stronger and then you sort of shut them down, I think that really set the tone and allowed the confidence of the offense to grow a little bit.
Thanks, Jeff. Kevin, a good balance of run and pass here in the first half. How would you assess the offensive performance?
Well, in a big game like this, you just want your kids to settle in a little bit. I know it's the tension, the pressure. We've had a couple of mistakes, missed assignments, you know, a couple of turnovers. But, you know, that's for first half, we can get in tight at halftime and sort of regroup and let the kids feel comfortable about where they are. I'm looking forward to second half. During the Annaly week, Wes Brumbaugh, with a bunch of alums, they showed up at our bonfire. Now, I know in 2011, I planned on having a bunch of alums show up at our bonfire, the Thanksgiving bonfire. But I didn't make any plans, and then next thing you know, we have all these alums show up for the bonfire. And then Wes, he asked if he could say something. He can be a funny guy, he can be very entertaining. And sure enough, he pulled out, you know, a speech at the Thanksgiving bonfire that got all the kids pumped up. So I remembered that. And when he was going down to state, I sent him some little jokes, you know, about like, hey, you know, if you're down here, I'm going to have you say something.
Heard a lot of stuff about comparisons to the 2011 state team, you know, from alums, coaches, parents, whatever. You aren't us. You have your own destiny, your own brotherhood here, your own history to the team. This is all you guys. I'm sure some of you, when you first, you know, heard the comparisons to our team, you thought that was awesome, the state team. I'm honored to be compared to you guys now. This team is something special. Not many people get to be where you guys are right now. There's only one thing you guys have to do to win this game, and that's play Campo football. Let's go, boys.
Campolindo and El Capitan all square 7-7 as we get ready for the second half kickoff. You see Brad Cagle on the other side, Jack Stevens. Pretty impressive first half. He did have the one interception and threw the touchdown pass on a very nice fade route to Max Flower. He's been pretty good here in the first half.
He has, and I love isolating those big receivers against the defensive backs for El Capitan. I think they can have a lot of success with that in the second half because I think the run game is going to be limited by the physicality of El Capitan up front.
Petit and Flower also, they've had big first halves. We'll see how they do when they get the football on offense. First, it'll be El Capitan who receives this kickoff. The Vaqueros of El Capitan with their second drive of the second half. Brad Cagle back to work. He who missed the last couple of possessions in the first half with a banged up ankle gets under center. Good starting field position on this second drive. Handed off to Smith, goes right side, bounces it outside, breaks off one, down the sideline he goes. Jukes once and then finally brought down to the 15-yard line. Second and very long. Cagle back, looking, and he has a catch and a touchdown. What a play and the concentration by Frankie Lima. El Capitan takes their first lead.
And I've always said winning league, and if you can go undefeated in league, even better. But winning leagues is bigger to me than what might happen in the playoffs.
One of the first goals the Campo team set at the beginning of the year is to make it to the Thanksgiving week, because then all the old players get to come back and watch the game.
You have your siblings from college, you have all the ex-alums, all the ex-greats come back.
It's like a time where you can look at the history behind all the football.
So we had kind of always been on Coach Macy to like get some new gear, some new stuff for us. And the off season and summer before the 2014 season, he caved in and we ended up getting these really sick red jerseys. And when they came in, everyone's like, oh my gosh, these are dope. So like we wanted to wear them whenever we could, but Coach Macy made sure that we saved them for special occasions, and he decided those special occasions were the homecoming game against Aquilani's and the Annaly game, the Thanksgiving week game.
The kids wanted to bring out the red jerseys. It was Thanksgiving, so you're thinking, okay, now you just don't want this thing to blow up in our faces.
So against Annaly, our tight end, Tyler Petit, I think he was running a drag or something. He got pretty close to Annaly's sideline, dropped the ball. Their defenders didn't really make a play. It was kind of just his mistake. And none of us really noticed this during the game, but later the next Monday when we were watching film, Coach Macy pointed out to us, but their head coach, who was about 30 or 40 yards down the field, as soon as Tyler drops the ball, starts jumping up and down, and then he starts high-stepping down and gets all into his face and starts like jumping around like he'd done something crazy. And it was just super funny watching that play.
I had one of my biggest plays of the year that game, and I just remember a cool moment of the season is after making the big play, I got called over to the sidelines because I was tired or whatever, the drive ended, and then I just had all the ex-alums, all the ex-receivers were kind of hanging out together and clustered on the sidelines, and they were all just kind of like giving me respect, and I was like, I don't know, I felt like the Campo receiver bond there, and it was just kind of a cool thing to have a good game when the alums were back and they could see it.
Annaly was probably, I thought, one of the toughest games we had because they were a huge offensive threat. And they know how to attack our defense like very well because they've played us a couple of times. They know that we kind of struggle on the deep outs and because our corners stay with their receivers and it's kind of the backers' responsibility.
Then the game went back and forth, and you know, you're just at times you're thinking, man, you know, it's going to be another one of these games, a last possession game type of a thing. And
thank you.
I really looked at it as a one-play game because when it came down to it, they had a two-point conversion that we stopped. And if we didn't stop that two-point conversion, you know, that would have changed the complexion of the game. I know once we got that stop, we then had a nice long drive. But still, even with the long drive coming down the field, it came down to, all right, we had a decision. Let's start planning what we're going to do on fourth down. But on the third down play, and Max Flower comes up with this incredible catch in the back corner of the end zone.
We kind of set up a play to where the best play for the situation was a 2-9. And I'd never run a 9 out of the slot before all year. And so I lined up in the slot for the first time and ran a 9 to the corner of the end zone. And Jack just kind of dropped back and hucked it up right before getting hit. And I was able to catch it in the corner of the end zone with all, a bunch of alumni standing right next to me. That was pretty cool.
So when Max makes the catch on third down, the relief on the sideline with all the coaches on the staff, you know, that, you know, it definitely pumped the kids up. But again, for the coaches, we were looking at that fourth down play. What are we going to do if we didn't come up with that third down? So after the game, it was very clear we had a lot of respect for them and that they were one of the stronger teams that we'd seen all year.
That's McNally. Goes far side. Brought down shy of the 40.
When you're used to scoring 46 plus points a game, now you've got 7 through half. I'd be a little chippy too.
One of only 3 teams in the state of California to score over 700 points. Deep drop by Stevens. Lays it out. And he's got Petit.
Campolindo staying on, and El Capitan had a false.
Go to the inside rush with McNally. Stevens hands off inside. That's McNally again on the fly sweep. And he's getting closer and closer to a first down inside the 20. For Stevens and his Campolindo Cougars trying to even the score. McNally again goes in motion. Stevens faked it to him, looking towards the end zone. Petit, did he get his toe in? No, he didn't. Incomplete. Got a 36-yard attempt by Matt Blair. Kick is blocked. It's Capucci. Comes away with it.
And that's, I believe that the ball's dead where they blocked it. I could be wrong with this one. They're returning it like it's a touchdown. What do I know, huh?
Just like being able to go through and then like playing the NCS championship, and granted it wasn't the same venue, but to still like have all of our fans out there, and then, you know, against the team that we beat a few years prior.
You know, going on the bus over there, actually we had a police escort, and there was like a bunch of students and parents in the parking lot, so I wouldn't say we were distracted, but I know that was just one of the things. Like, you go into a championship game, you really want to like stay focused. And I think that kind of, led us down the path where you get unfocused and everything like that. But I think we eventually rebounded and got ready for our game.
After the Amalie game, the Marin Catholic game, the last time we played them was in the Coliseum for the North Coast Section Championship. So even though you just, you know, one game can make a rivalry when it's a playoff team.
I got a jet sweep and hadn't really been doing too well with that the entire year, but I got it to the right side, and I just remember running down, seeing like five nuns like staring at me, and you know, I winked at them right when I scored in the end zone. So that's pretty sweet.
Yeah, big thing about our defense is I feel like we had a lot of guys that would step up in the clutch.
When you need that big stop, you're willing to give that extra effort and try for anything.
I remember after the game, after we won, I got to hold the plaque and run it to the fans.
I guess now you can say we just have a classic rivalry with Marin Catholic.
Campolindo offense has been stalled here in the second half by the great El Capitan defense. Second down and four. They put Ramoto in motion. Ball fake to Fedeli. Stevens rolling right, throwing right, and incomplete.
Third and three here. Keep playing. Plenty of time left. I know you're frustrated. You're used to scoring 46 points a game, but you know everybody knew that this game was going to be a little bit tighter than that, so still got to buckle up here.
It's a big third down attempt for Campolindo. Stevens flushing left, looking towards the middle, firing down the middle. Flower can't bring it in. Back to receive this punt from Blair.
Don't just kick it to him and let the wheels fall off here, huh? Stay to your game plan. Don't let him beat you.
Low snap gets away from Blair, and there's Malero.
But Sam Malero really doing an outstanding job in all phases today.
Here's Capucci, right side end zone, touchdown. Isaiah Capucci. Runs one in, and El Cap in charge.
Yeah, we had a lot of heartache that was going to be built into the season, the playoff run. It started the day of the Marin Catholic game. Mark McGinn gives me a call. He's pretty shaken up. One of our ex-coaches, a very close friend of all of us, but especially Mark McGinn, Glenn Martin, passed away that morning. So, you know, that one caught us off guard. Here we are, we're going into the championship game. We find out a close friend died unexpectedly. And so that, you know, that we carried that into the game. Well, then at the same time, we had just gotten word that Bob Wilson, longtime coach, athletic director, head freshman coach, mentor, you know, just so close with everybody in the program and in the community. He'd been battling cancer. And I had a parent, I said, could you please, you know, find a way, an appropriate way for us to go over with the team and see Bob. I don't know what's appropriate, but I wanted someone to do some back channel work to see what could happen. Well, at one point, this parent came back and said, well, maybe just bring the captains. So I told the kids, right, well, we didn't know what day it was going to be, but we thought the captains were going to go. And we talked about, well, the rest of the team's going to go, and we'll just keep like a little vigil outside. We would just wait outside while the captains went in. So we were just waiting to find out when that day might be. And then when we got the word, it was the day before the Sutter game. They said 4 o'clock. You know, that was the time they wanted us to do it. That night, I got a picture made up with some text on it. I found a picture of, I took a picture of all the kids in front of the sign up in front of the stadium. It says Bob Wilson. We put all the kids around it that played for Bob. Our juniors and seniors made up Bob's last two freshman teams. I quickly rushed that night, got some text on it, blew it up. You know, we took it to Bob to present it to him. So when we went over, you know, we thought the kids would stand outside, and then all of a sudden Bob's wife Emily invited the complete team in. So we went inside and we packed around, and Bob, you know, he was great. Bob was sort of came to life, and he was talking about, you know, expecting to see us at state, wishing he'd be there.
Coach Wilson was, you know, our inspiration, like during the Sutter game.
Against Sutter, I really was horrible at the beginning of the game. I was like 1-for-7 with a pick or something. Was overthrowing screens, op blocks, whatever it may be. And then Max ran a stop, and it was something we practiced with Sko a couple times, but we kind of forgot about it, and we both instinctively like remembered the slice, which is an extension of the stop, and hit it, and kind of he broke in the middle of the field for like, I don't know, 40-something yards, and clumsy Max couldn't score, but it was still a cool play. Ever since then, I kind of caught fire, and that led to probably my favorite play of the year. It's called the Y-Pop 8, and Caleb Whalen. He runs like a deep post, and I play action and just throw it as far as I can, and we just hit it perfectly. And we'd been practicing it all week, and Coach Macy was all over it, and that was his play. That was something that I didn't think I could do at the beginning of the season, so I think deep in the season, I kind of proved I could throw a good deep ball, and it was awesome.
Knowing our high-powered offense, I felt like that was definitely something that helped us keep composure when we got down, because we'd put on points in bunches throughout the whole season. So when we got down 14 in Sutter, or we got down big in state, we knew that we put points on the board really quick. So it definitely helped just kind of give us level heads, and it was definitely a fun thing. I got to do a ton of chest bumps and high fives and celebrations in the end zone because we had a lot of guys that were scoring.
The quarterback. He was like supposed to be a gunslinger, but he just threw moon balls, and our secondary had a field day.
And the next week, you know, you're thinking, oh, great, Bob will have a chance to watch the game on TV. And then Wednesday we find out that Bob passed away. So that, you know, I thought, thank God our kids had a chance to see Bob. We really would have felt bad if we never could have made that last visit. So I think maybe that was a gift from Bob that he allowed us to come and meet with him. And I didn't find out till later when we did the celebration of life for Bob at the school. You know, you know, a good 6 weeks from his death before they wanted to do something at the school. And when that was being planned, Emily at the time told me that Bob hadn't spoken for a couple of days before the team came into the room to meet him. And then she also said that was the last time he did speak. So he really rallied up for the kids. You know, so we did carry a heavy heart down to the state game, and And eventually that Bob's presence was felt in a lot of places. I mean, all the kids personally carried Bob's spirit with them. And then when we once we found out he passed away, he said, we're not going to ask you to dedicate the state game to him, but dedicate the way you're going to play that game to Bob. You know, play in his spirit. Play with the fight that Bob would expect you to play.
That ended up being one of our biggest motivations in the state game, to win for Bob. And even during the third quarter, I think, when we were down by all those points, at one point in the student section started chanting, "Do it for Wilson," and I feel like that just helped to inspire the team.
And then I know there was a situation where there was a play that I wanted to call. A couple of times I tried to call for it, and Chris Schofield just did. It never been one of his favorite plays. It's you know, you fake a stretch one way and you sort of boot back and throw a blind screen back on the other side. And that's the part that's always bothered Chris. He thought the quarterback's going to get killed, it's going to get intercepted. So I walked over to him and I said, "Chris, can we just do the throwback screen?" And Chris just looked at me and goes, "I can't do it. I can't do it, Coach. If you want it, you got to call it." So, okay. So I told the kids to do the throwback screen.
Play fake. LaChapa was in the neighborhood. They set up the screen. Nobody's out in the flat. Here's Romoto barreling his way towards the end zone and in. Touchdown, Campolindo, a perfect play call towards the end of the third quarter.
So that's the one that Romoto catches for a touchdown and just got us that score right at the end of the third quarter. And I walked over to Chris and I said, "Chris, I won't bother you anymore. You know, I'll leave you alone the rest of the game."
But look at the blocking by the receivers.
Well, you're getting Max Flower to finish Isaiah Capucci out of the play.
A lot of my touchdowns, you can see Max in the film knocking people to the ground and making a big hole for me, so I got to give him credit for that. Yeah, having the big guys out there blocking for you really helps a lot.
So I think we just, you know, it just sort of stabilized things. We just sort of relaxed a little bit, and we didn't go into fast panic mode. The defense then shut everything down.
Smith hammered at the line of scrimmage. Cagle, left side, incomplete. Cromwell able to give it away, and it's a knuckleball. Takes a El Capitan bounce down to the 21-yard line. First down run by Fedeli. Pressure. Stevens gets rid of it. Wide open is Romoto. Down the near sideline, and it's DJ Smith that brings him down to the 25-yard line. And here come the charging Cougars. Stevens on the play pass. Going towards the end zone. Caught, touchdown. That's Romoto with his second receiving touchdown of the game. Campolindo has scored 13 unanswered. Completion and hauls in that one for 13. The extra point from Blair, right through the uprights.
After Marin Catholic at DVC, I noticed that like a day or two later, I had kind of like a cut on my eye a little bit, and it started to become a black eye, and I thought that was kind of cool. I've never really had a black eye, so I was like, oh, kind of badass, I got a black eye. But I came to school on Monday and Coach Macy was loving it, seeing that he said I looked like a boxer, just gone a couple rounds. So, and also, my helmet was kind of loose that game and it kind of came down on my face and cut my nose up a little bit. And actually for the Sutter game, that kind of became a problem because every time I would like get hit or hit someone, the helmet would come down and open up and I would start bleeding everywhere, so I had to have to come out and they would glue my face up a little bit. You can also see it, I think in the state game, you can see Sproul just, he's walking off with me and he's just holding my nose to make sure it doesn't bleed anymore. But yeah, it was definitely, I thought it was kind of cool to get a black eye.
Gives to Smith, goes outside and brought down. They hand it off to Smith, tries the right side again. Still takes a couple of Cougars to bring him down, brings up a big third down play. Handoff goes to Smith, met in the backfield, and he can't break through. Another big stop by the Cougars.
Campolindo about to get the ball back with the opportunity to drive down and tie this thing up.
That was Gelmas in the backfield. The gentleman who was down on the play a couple of plays before, able to stop the momentum. Big kick from Cromwell. Here comes Campolindo. They're going to set up shop at the 39-yard line. Flushed out to the right. And he's going to take it himself and run out of bounds near the 45. New set of downs, first and 10. Play fake. Going deep is Stevens. Petit is out there. Petit gets up, makes the catch at the 15-yard line. Stevens looks out to Flower, who's got it in the flat. Towards the end zone, reaches out. He stretches for a score. Max Flower's second touchdown reception of the game. Now, an extra point away from tying it up. Here's Blair, who splits the uprights. And 21 unanswered points from Campolindo.
We were in perfect position that I said, we're going to get the ball back and score again. You know, we'll pin them back. They're completely panicked right now. Their offense had been throttled down. I said, we're going to kick it deep. We're going to pin them back. They'll punt to us. We'll come right down the field and score and win. The next thing you know, they got the ball in midfield. And what compounded things was that I've got Romoto and Petit down on the sideline. They can't go out on defense. We got the only other backup we had was a sophomore, Nicky Moore. Well, he's a skinny little rail, and we had to put him out there. And all of a sudden, everything we had done to claw our way back in the game, we're just giving it all away. And the defense was still tough. I mean, they kept converting fourth down by inches. And then all of a sudden, now they're in a position where, you know, their kicker was not that great, but they're like, all right, they're, you know, we got to at least hold them to some type of a kick and hope something goes wrong. And, you know, all of a sudden, you know, they run this reverse.
One-on-one on the near side if you're looking at Lima. Going to run the reverse. That's Malero. Scoots out of one tackle down the sideline, breaks another and near the 10-yard line.
The play that they ran, the reverse, I just turned to Romoto and Petit. They're both standing on the sideline next to me. I turn to them and I go, when the hell are you guys going to get back out there?
Coach Macy sees me on the sideline and starts yelling at me. Like, are you going to stand on the sideline and watch this team take the game? So it was at that moment I went up to Coach Matt and said, put me in. And
so all of a sudden they just sort of dogged their way out. But they went to the left side of our defense. The reverse was first play they're in, the reverse goes in the other direction.
From the 12 and 1:10 on the clock.
And then next play, you know, they ran it back inside, and Tyler really just blew the play.
Kegel feeds Cappucci.
To be honest, I thought it was just a tackle and play was over, but little did I know, everyone starts going crazy and sprinting down the field, and I'm just like, what's going on? And Adam has the ball.
I was actually pretty close to picking up the ball, but Adam beat me to it.
Kegel feeds Cappucci. The right end, and he's brought down, loses the football. Go the other way. It's Romoto.
Tegan made a great hit, and it was right there for me. Seeing all that open field was, I just got goosebumps right now. It's just thinking about it, it's crazy that could happen. Coach Macy always talks about how it was Bob Wilson giving his little touch on that game. That was his play, which, I mean, that's really the only way you can describe it. Last minute fumble right on their 10-yard line and running it all the way back. That's not something anyone can predict.
So it just seemed poetic that it happened that way. But you know, once again, we were on the verge of everyone just let him score. and the next thing, then that miracle play. So it's just so many ironies that are layered behind, the little things, the big things. Are just so much that's hidden that the coaching staff knows about that the rest of the world doesn't.
There was like 55 seconds or something like that on the clock left on the kickoff, and there's always that chance that they could score somehow. But
that one, so gonna need some more of that Brad Cagle magic. There's Malero on the return, ball pops out again. Campolindo thinks they have it, and they do. Fumbles on back-to-back plays by El Capitan, and the defense for Campolindo comes up huge. Valero trying to make something happen here on the return.
I hit the guy and knocked the ball loose, even though I didn't get credit for it. They gave it to some sophomore, Burzins, but you watch that tape, and it was me, number 18. Knocked that ball loose.
He took credit for, but they said Joey Burzins forced the fumble.
That one. It was Joey Burzins who came in and forced it, number 87.
So goes Campolindo to their first state championship in school history.
Stevens takes a knee, and coach going crazy with the student section as the Campolindo Cougars come away with their first CIF State Bowl championship victory.
Of my career. And the state thing was nice, but inducting Nick and the other guys tonight, you know, I feel that's the rewarding thing to see these kids sort of come full circle. And our program, you know, our kids at one state, they don't sit there and say, oh, we're the best team. They don't do that at all. They know that they're part of a bigger picture. They're very humble about winning state. They really don't talk much about it. They really talk about the past teams, and they compare themselves to the past teams. They really look at those older kids and what they remember from those kids teaching them at summer camps and being the models for them. So this is really a night for to celebrate inductees, the community, and winning games is nice, but there's always a bigger picture that we're trying to present tonight. This really ignites and kicks off our season. We start spring practice next week, and all the kids should be energized. So thanks for everyone for being here. We look forward to seeing you next year.
Campbell football is not really something you can ever walk away from, just because, I mean, it brings so many memories.
I love Campbell football. My brother started playing on varsity in 2007, and ever since then I've been to literally every game. Went up to Fortuna, which is horrible, but it's still something that I can talk about, and not a lot of people were there, and Coach Macy has all these stories, and, you know, just so many cool places, not cool places, but we've been to just Cardinal Newman and Fortuna and all these crazy games that I was fortunate enough to be at. I've been at losses. I've been through horrible seasons. I've been through the greatest seasons. So I think that being in the program for so long with my brothers, I kind of have a good scope of what Campo football really is and what it represents and all the good things and what Coach Macy has done through good times and bad times and how consistent he's stayed with how he treats people and the players and everything.
Yeah, I always get a little lump in my throat at graduation in general, but then when we finish the graduation ceremony, we've done this for years, we get all the football kids immediately down in the end zone by the scoreboard, and we try to get some last big group picture together, all the parents rush around real quick. They know the importance, you know, and the bond that all the kids have, and you're thinking, you know, You know these kids more than just their 4 years, because especially that group, they came through the summer camps early. They had older brothers. I mean, there's a bloodline that ran through all the kids on that team. So it's not just a group of kids that just happened to play together in high school.
He's the key to all this. He's the key to our success, the key to the traditions. that's the biggest thing. Like, just him bringing us, his number one thing is brotherhood. And regardless, win or losses, just like going through hard things together and doing hard work together, like building that brotherhood up with people that you trust and you love, that's like the biggest, biggest thing.
10, 15, 20 years from now when we all get together, it's gonna be about all the memories and the crazy stuff that we did over the summer and at practice and whatnot, instead of the X's and O's and the catches and the sacks and all that stuff. That's awesome, but that's not really what we play for.
You know, coming back as an alumni is gonna be weird for the first time after, you know, that Thanksgiving break's your first opportunity to come home. It'll be weird walking up to that field without your helmet on, your shoulder pads on, all your game stuff on.
And you know that they're gonna go off in a lot of different directions, and you hope that bond that they have will always bring them back. We see it every Thanksgiving when all the kids rally back, you know, hoping that we're playing over Thanksgiving. We'll be following them, and we're going to hope that they make all the right choices in life, you know, and that their bonds that they develop in the football stays with them, and they'll keep finding their way back to Campo football. And we're going to stay here to make sure they got a home to come back to.
Yeah, I was just...